Recordings from a single neuron in a cerebral column cannot reveal how the brain works. And such recordings cannot be used for testing the two levels hypothesis. For that, we must use alpha waves. This video explains why. The column in the cerebral cortex is a central concept. It is the columns that are the functional units in the cortex. The cerebral cortex is a folded layer of gray matter, and this layer is the outer part of the cerebrum. The name column comes from the shape of the functional unit. A column contains many neurons, and these neurons form a narrow cylinder. The columns extend from the surface of the cortex to the white matter. The total number of columns is large, and the columns together create a layer of gray matter. You can say that the cortex is composed of columns. There are five arguments against recording from a single neuron in a cerebral column. The main point is that high activity in a column is a rare event. The two levels hypothesis states that the activity in a column is either at a high level or a low level. And only a few columns are expected to be highly active at a time. Finding one of these few columns is like looking for a needle in a haystack. Although unlikely, it is not impossible for a recording electrode in a column to capture the high activity. Rare events do occur. However, a rare finding of activity that occurred spontaneously can be hard to repeat. A result that is difficult to replicate is not convincing. Another problem is that recording from a single neuron is an invasive technique. There is always some degree of damage when recording from single neurons. Damage caused by the recording electrode can sometimes lead to high activity that lasts for a short time. This activity is probably much more common than genuine high activity. Consciousness is necessary if the aim is to capture the high activity in a column. Therefore, we cannot use general anesthesia. It is hard to find circumstances that justify recordings from single neurons without proper anesthesia. The fifth argument against single neurons is that the recordings cannot give the number of highly active columns. It is an unrealistic project to have such a vast number of electrodes that they could record the activity separately in all columns. If we stick to single neurons, we will never understand how the brain organizes its activity. We will remain unaware of the two levels. And we do not have the slightest chance to measure the actual number of columns with high activity. The figure shows an example of alpha waves. The waves contain information about the number of highly active columns. To retrieve that information, you need to decipher the waves. According to the two levels hypothesis, a regulating system keeps the number of highly active columns within appropriate limits. The signals from the regulating system are visible as alpha waves. There is thus a link between the alpha waves and the number of highly active columns. But how do you proceed from here? Two parameters determine the length of the alpha waves. These two are the number of highly active columns and the duration of high activity. In short, number and duration. The length of the alpha waves varies, and there are patterns in the variation. Analysis of such patterns makes it possible to measure the number and duration. The figure illustrates an alpha wave pattern. The time between two neighboring vertical lines is the wavelength. Green symbols indicate that some waves are a little shorter than other waves. Usually you have to plot the data in a diagram before the alpha wave pattern becomes visible. But occasionally, as in this figure, you can see the pattern already with the naked eye. The lower part of the figure shows the result of the analysis. Colorful horizontal lines represent high activity in individual columns. A wavelength chart is the best method for finding the alpha wave pattern. The red and blue symbols indicate a biphasic pattern where the interval is 5 alpha waves. This sequence of alpha waves allows you to measure the number of highly active columns and the duration of high activity. The number alternated between 4 and 5, while the mean duration was 470 milliseconds. The interval for the alpha wave pattern reveals the number of highly active columns. By moving the yellow curve 5 steps to the right, you can check that you got the correct interval. The bottom diagram shows the difference in wavelength, which is the difference between a wavelength and the average of the wavelengths one step before and one step after. This way of displaying data reduces the effect of slow fluctuations in wavelength. In this example, the probability that the alpha wave pattern occurred by pure chance is very low. The alpha wave patterns exist because the turnover of highly active columns has a slightly uneven distribution. There would be no pattern if we had an even distribution of the turnover. When high activity in a column starts a little early, it will also stop a little early. Then the next column can start its activity slightly early. The duration of high activity thereby sets the interval for the pattern. Alpha waves have an excellent temporal resolution, and you can measure the duration of high activity in an individual column. But alpha waves cannot show the location of the column. We must remember that alpha waves are widespread. The signals from the regulating system reach all columns. And these signals give us the alpha waves. There are limitations when measuring number and duration. You can analyze alpha wave patterns only under certain conditions. Long sequences of alpha waves must be present, and the amount of noise and other disturbances must be minimal. Currently, the analysis of a sequence of alpha waves is time-consuming. In summary, alpha wave patterns confirm the two levels hypothesis. Measurements from alpha waves give the duration of high activity. The waves also show the exact number of highly active columns.